And it's so nice, Scott, having those strings behind us like that. It's wonderful. Thank you for coming. Amen. Thank you. All right, so we're going to continue on in our series, Born Free. This is Born Free Part 4. If you've been born again, then the second birth has erased your original identity. Your original identity was the identity of a slave to sin. That's no longer who you are anymore. You've been converted. You're no longer a slave. You're now a son of a king. You're a son and a daughter of God. And not only are you a son, but you're not a son that's in slavery. You're a son that is free. Why, if we are free, do you suppose so many people continue on in a life of bondage even after they get saved? It's a good question. The Bible says we're free, but do you ever feel like there's still some areas in your life you're not free in? Yeah? Think about it. I think it would be hard for most people that are Christians to say, I feel that I'm completely free in every area. I think that would be a difficult thing to say, don't you? But the Bible says we are supposed to be free. That's what it says anyway. John 8, 34 and 36 says this. Jesus replied, very truly I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. That's scripture, isn't it? Has the Son set you free? The Bible says if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. You see, not just free in a limited sense, but free indeed. I mean, for real. Really free. That's what the Bible says. Do you really feel completely free? Is the Word of God ever wrong? That's a question for you. That's a good answer. The Word of God is never wrong because the Word of God comes from God, and God kind of knows His business. He knows what's going on, doesn't He? Yeah. The Word of God is never wrong. And the Word of God says about you, if you've accepted Jesus as your Savior, it says that you have been set free indeed. That's what the Word of God says. You may say, yeah, okay, I'll accept that it says that. And we accept a lot of things by faith that we don't necessarily feel, don't we? Well, yes, it says that. So I guess in a figurative sense, somehow, in some way, in God's eyes, or some kind of person's eyes, I must be free, but I sure don't feel free. That's the way most people live their lives. They don't feel free. Is God's word ever wrong? It's just not wrong. If the word says that the Son sets you free, and you're free indeed, then was Jesus mistaken? Was Jesus lying to us? Does Jesus ever lie? Then why doesn't this statement line up with what we consider our reality? If it doesn't line up, then it seems like it's not correct. It seems like it's wrong. Now notice I said it seems like. I didn't say it was wrong. I said it seems like that. When you watch a magician make a person disappear, it seems like they really disappeared, doesn't it? When you watch a magician saw a person in half and then move half of them over here and half of them over there, and they're moving their foot over here and they're talking to you over here with their face over here, it appears they're really in two pieces, doesn't it? It seems like the magician actually sawed somebody in half. And some people are fooled. Some people, the trick is so good, they go, wow, they must have some kind of spiritual power. But a magician is just an illusionist. A magician is a fake. A magician uses tricks. A magician uses sleight of hand. Now, back at the turn of the century, there was a magician named Houdini. And there was also somebody else who was very famous, a man named Arthur Conan Doyle. And Arthur Conan Doyle was a very intelligent man. And he was the man who wrote Sherlock Holmes. And he was a very intelligent man of high caliber of thinking. He could he could really, make sense out of complex things. And yet, that man, Arthur Conan Doyle, when he saw Houdini go from one side of a brick wall to the other when a curtain was lifted and instantaneously he was on the other side, he said, I believe Houdini actually has the power to dematerialize and rematerialize. He has power, spiritual power. Mm-hmm. Houdini said, it's a trick. He says, no, you're hiding it from us. You really have spiritual power. It was such a convincing trick that he said, look, I saw it with my own eyes. It was instantaneous. There's no way a person could get from that side of a brick wall to that side of a brick wall in a moment. It's got to be for real. And he said, listen, it's a trick. No, you just don't want us to know. I want you to know there's lots of things that appear to be real, that appear to be true in your life, that are illusions that have been created by the master illusionist, by the devil. The Bible says that in the end times, the devil and his folks will perform things called lying signs and wonders. They look real. They look authentic, but they're illusions. The devil is the greatest illusionist on the face of the earth. We have to not forget that the master illusionist is ever around you. He is always trying to trick you. He's always trying to deceive you. He's always trying to get you to believe in a lie so that you will reject the truth because you can't hold on to both at the same time. You see, either you're free or you're in bondage. You can't be both, can you? So the devil wants to create a reality for you, an illusion for you that says, well, I know what the Bible says, but I know I'm not free. I know what the Bible says, but I don't feel free. I don't seem free. I think the Bible must be talking about somebody else, some other group of people, maybe somebody who's, who's gotten to some great point spiritually, very high peak spiritually, and then they're finally free, but not me. But that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says, that's what it says, he who the Son sets free is free indeed. But I don't feel free. I know you don't. And the devil counts on you operating on feelings. The devil counts on you operating on what you see. Because he's an illusionist. Now, magicians can be so good, they cause rational people to actually once in a while question, maybe he does have some kind of power. Maybe it's a demonic power. Maybe he really did do magic there. But I'm going to tell you, they're all fake. The best of them are all fake, okay? I always liked magic as a kid because I wanted to know how it worked. I always wanted to know how things work. And so one time, I got to see something I wasn't supposed to see because my wife and I went on a cruise, and they had a stage that was not optimal for a magician because it was half round. So I could get around to the side and look behind the magician and see what he was doing back here. The audience is going, oh my goodness, oh, did you see that? And I'm going, saw how he did it. It's a fake. It's a fake. I saw everything that he did. I learned a whole lot about how a lot of those tricks worked. And suddenly, the curtain was up, the jig was up, my eyes were open. I was going, well, that was simple. That was so stupidly simple. I can't believe people fell for it. But they fell for it. It looks real. I guarantee you, the master illusionist is on duty right now. The devil wants to appear in your life and cause you to believe things that are not true. And they will seem so true, they will seem so real that you will buy them. And once you buy a lie, you've rejected the truth. And once you reject the truth, you will find that you will be subject to that lie that you believe is a reality. Because what the Bible says about truth, it says that when you know the truth, it makes you free. And therefore, if you, even being a free man, begin to accept lies, guess what? You've just given up freedom in a certain area. And the devil wants you to believe the things that he's trying to sell you so that you will remain bound even though you've been set completely free. He wants you to believe that you're not free because if you believe you're not free, there's a lot of things you won't even attempt to do. Okay? There's, it's the best analogy that there ever was, and that's why it's been overused, but there's that analogy about the elephant, okay? Here it comes again. It's the perfect analogy. Like in Thailand, they used elephants years ago to harvest lumber, and they were their bulldozer, the elephant, And so you'd catch a wild elephant sometimes in the jungle, and and you'd want to basically break his will. You'd want to train the elephant. Elephants don't want to be trained when they're wild, and so they would chain the elephant's rear leg to a tree. And it was a type of tree that would bend so it wouldn't break. And the elephant would tug and tug and tug, and he had this iron ring around his leg, and the iron ring would dig into his leg, it would cause it to get raw, and he would tug less hard because it hurt. And he would tug less and less and less, and someday, finally, he'd give up tugging. And he'd look down and go, what's the use? I'm a prisoner. There's no use in yanking. It isn't going to do any good. I give up. And then they would take the chain off of the tree but leave the shackle on his ankle. And he would be walking around completely free, but he'd look down at his ankle and go, no use in running. I can't get away. Not realizing the whole time he's actually completely free. You see, when the sun sets you free, you were made completely free, but the devil has shown you that no, not for you. That's for somebody else. Just look down at your ankle. The shackle's still there. You're a prisoner. You can't do those things. That's for some group of people. That's for some elite kind of a Christian. That's not for you. But you see, he's an illusionist. He's a liar. And you have to know what is truth and what is a lie. Because when you know the truth, you can be in freedom in that area. Jesus said that if he sets you free, you're free indeed. But in your mind, you're saying, I'm certainly not free indeed. Because that's the deception that we've bought. When you say this, you are stating that Jesus is wrong. That's what you're doing. You're stating that Jesus perhaps is a liar. What you feel you are saying is true. You feel it is true, but what you're saying is setting itself above what the Word of God says about you. Now, the devil is very deceptive. He's very crafty. He's very slick at his trade. He can fool most humans. He has super intellect. He's far smarter than us. And you see, the only way we can defeat him is through the Spirit of God. But if we try to defeat him using our natural mind, we don't have a chance. He knows far more than you'll ever know of how to trick people. So we have to depend on the Spirit of God. And God knows that. And God has given us weapons to be able to defend ourselves with. He's given us weapons to fight with. And he didn't give us weapons that the Bible describes, these weapons cutting demons in two and slicing them and dicing them. It doesn't talk about that. But it says these weapons have a particular function. Okay? You see, you don't use a bow and arrow to take down a castle wall. That's not the way it works. You use a different kind of a weapon, don't you? Well, the Lord has given us a particular type of weaponry to use, and it's for a particular type of situation. And you have to use the weapons for what they're made for. So here's what the Bible says. 2 Corinthians 10:3-5. For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. We wage war in a different way. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of this world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. They can demolish strongholds. Okay, and here are the strongholds. We demolish arguments. Wait, those are just words. Yes, they are words. They are words that have lodged in your mind. They are words that are contrary to the Word of God. They are words that will keep you in bondage. That is the power the devil has over you, is his lies. When you reject his lies and accept the truth, guess what? The stronghold falls. So we have power. We have been given weapons to demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. Everything that says, I know what the Word says, but my experience is quite different. Everything, well, the Word says I'm free, but I'm really not free. You're putting your knowledge above the knowledge of God, because God says, yes, you are free. You're free indeed, in fact. That's what the Bible says. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. So when you have that disobedient thought, the thought that says, I am not free, and Christ says, but I set you free, you take it captive and you say, listen, I don't listen to you. I trust the Son of God over what I feel. Because what I feel can be deceptive. The devil operates in the realm of feelings and thoughts. And the devil deceives you in the area of feelings and thoughts. And the great stage where the great illusionist works the greatest is in your mind. That's why the Bible talks about the importance of renewing the mind, because the mind is the stage that is set where the magician does his work, where he does his best work. And if he can deceive you into believing a lie, you will walk around as one who never really was set free. That's what the devil tries to do. Everything that does not match up with God's word is a lie. It's an illusion. It must be rejected, no matter how real it feels. So how can the devil trick so many free people into believing they are prisoners? John 8:31 says this, 31 and 32, to the Jews who had believed in him, Jesus said, if you hold to my teachings, you are my disciples. Then, if you hold my teachings, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. It is the truth that sets you free, but it isn't just the truth being in existence, because the truth is in existence. It's there. It's in the Bible. It says you have to know it. When you know the truth will set you free. This word know is a Greek word ginosko, which means when you come to the realization, when you recognize it, when you acknowledge it, when you go, ah, that's true. You see, it doesn't even say that you must have an understanding of how it all works. It just means you have to acknowledge, that's true. I get it. That's true. Jesus said it, so it's true. If you don't come to realize, if you don't come to recognize, if you don't begin to acknowledge what is really true, then the lies of the enemy will deceive you and keep you from walking in freedom. The lies are the things that bind the free believer. It's just the lies. It's all the smoke and mirrors. Once you recognize the truth, the lies no longer have power over you. The strongholds are torn down. I want to talk to you a little bit about the word knowledge. There are different levels of knowledge that we can function in this world, all right? There is a knowledge that all of us in this room have, and that is the knowledge that a switch on a wall, when it is flipped up, turns on lights. You can function at that level of knowledge quite comfortably in life and get along okay in this world. Well, you know, I flip that, the light goes on. But there are other levels of knowledge. There's a level of knowledge that is deeper than that, where it says, I know how electricity works, I know how the switch works, I know how the light bulb works. But you don't need any of that to operate the switch, do you?
That's right.
Now, you can send a text on your phone, you can make a call on your cell phone, and even a 3-year-old can make a call on a cell phone nowadays. Yeah. Is that right? They play games on cell phones I don't even know how to play, right? So they can operate the thing. Do you suppose a 3-year-old has any idea how that works? His level of knowledge is this. I push the button and it works. That's his level of knowledge. Our level of knowledge is I put the characters in there and push a send and it gets sent. You don't have to understand radio waves, satellites, transmitting signals. You don't have to understand electronics. You don't have to understand chips. You don't have to understand resistors and transistors. You don't have to understand any of that. You can operate and function perfectly comfortable at the level of just knowing I push the button and it works. Is that right? But here is the problem. Most of us do not operate that way when it comes to spiritual things. Most of us do not operate in what the Bible calls childlike faith. Childlike faith is, I push the button and it happens. Right. Most of us want to operate on a different level. We say this. We say, Lord, I'll believe it after you completely explain to me how it works.
Right.
Yeah. You want me to believe that? That's beyond me. Hey, you know what? How a cell phone works is beyond me, but I believe it. I don't need to understand it to use it. I use it, and I really couldn't care less how it works. It just works. But the Lord says, I want you to be that way with my word. I want you to get to the point to where because I said it, you simply believe it. Because I said it, you simply operate in it. You don't need to get a full understanding because your natural mind says, I must understand everything. I had a problem in math when I was in school. My problem was this. When I got to higher math, as high as I went anyway, you know, when I got to higher math, there were things called theorems, and they were like an equation that you plug in to do figure out a certain kind of problem. I had problems with those things because they would say, okay, so here's the equation. It wants to know what the angle of this is and the circumference of that and blah, blah, blah. Plug in this theorem for that case. And I go, but wait a minute, teacher. I want to understand how this thing works. I don't get this equation. It's just a bunch of numbers to me. It's a bunch of numbers and letters. I don't know how that changes this into that. Can you explain that to me? And they would say, don't worry about how it works. Just plug it in. I couldn't get over that. I said, I've got to understand how it works before I can use it. And when I understand how it works, then I'll understand the importance of having it at this particular time. They said, no, just do it. That's hard for me. That's hard for me. A lot of us are that way spiritually. A lot of us are that way spiritually. You see, I had set up in my mind certain things spiritually that I couldn't believe till I fully understood certain things in a certain way. And you know what? That was a problem because many things the Lord will teach us after we believe them, not before we believe them.
Right.
Many of the explanations that you're looking for come after you believe, not before you believe. And many of us say, once you prove it to me, then I'll believe it. And God says, you got it all backwards, dude. You got to believe it, and then I'll show you how it works. There are some things that I operate in spiritually that I still don't know how they work, but I don't care because they work. That's the level we've got to get to with God, because it's a level of trust that a child has with his parent. The level of trust says, if daddy says this works, then I'm going to do it. I'm not going to ask questions. I don't need an explanation because daddy says it works. I don't need to know how that light switch works to push it up and get the lights to go on, do I? So I had created in my mind all this stuff, all this knowledge that I had to have before certain things would work in my life. And really, it was just a futile thing that I had created. I created myself difficulties in functioning in things because I had to understand everything. And I've come to the point of realizing all the stuff I thought I understood, there's still a lot of it I really understood incorrectly. So I just need to accept it because God said it. You know? We need to not reject what God says, but accept what God says. We've imposed certain spiritual conditions on things before we'll accept them, that we would never impose on natural things. When I was a little boy and I learned how to work the light switch, I didn't say, I can't use that. I don't understand how it works yet. I just did it, didn't I? In our carnal natural mind, we say to the Word of God many times, I see what you're saying, but I'm not going to believe it till you show me how it works. Till you convince my natural mind. Till you settle all my questions. Till you answer every objection I might have. Until I get all that down, I can't quite believe that. You know what? That kind of faith or lack of faith will keep you from walking in freedom. It will keep you from walking in healing. I spent years trying to find the keys for praying to the sick, for seeing God's miracles manifested. I'd imposed all kinds of conditions on how it had to work. I had said, because I'd studied so many men of God who knew what they were doing, I thought, I'd said, unless I say it exactly this way and put the name of Jesus at the beginning and the name of Jesus at the end and say these scriptures in the middle, until I do it that, nothing's going to happen. I had said that unless I get that person that I'm praying for to be in complete agreement with me, in fact, I got to get them saved first and get them in complete agreement with me. Unless I do that, they won't get their healing. You know? I had said that if they have some unforgiveness in their heart, they won't get healed. That's just the way it is. So before I could pray for anybody, I first of all had to find out their life story. Okay, now let's go down the checklist. Are you saved? Have you accepted Jesus as your Savior? Do you have any unforgiveness for anybody? Da, 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 da. Sorry, can't pray for you. You can't be healed. Or I'd pray for them, and I'd wonder as I'm praying for them, I wonder if they got any unforgiveness. If they will, this isn't going to work. And then I met a man. And this man had childlike faith. And this man simply went to people and he would, anything he did, he'd blow on someone and go, and he'd go test it out. They were healed. He'd touch them. They were healed. He'd say, here, hold this card. They were healed. And I'm going, that's not supposed to work. You're not saying this name in this way, and there may not even be saved. He was praying for people and said, I don't even believe in healing, and they got healed. I said, that's not supposed to work. And he said to me, he said, look, Here's what the Bible says. The Bible says this. You know, all the stuff you're saying, you got to say and think and all this. What the Bible actually says is this, is if you're a believer, you lay your hands on the sick and they recover. It doesn't even say you have to say anything. Oh, that's true. It just says lay your hands on them, they recover. Blew my mind. Then I saw people getting healed. And then I actually experienced it myself. I saw somebody who said, that won't work. That won't work. And I prayed for them. They got healed anyway. And go, all this time, I wasn't just taking God for his word. His word just says, you pray for them, they'll be healed. I said, no. It doesn't work that way. You've got to understand how it all functions. I was just wrong. I had to throw it all out the window and just say, you know what? God said it. That's it. God said it. You just do it. It works. I had to come back to a place of childlike faith. I had to come back to a place to say, I don't need to understand everything that God is doing. I just need to understand what he wants me to do. He wanted us to come to him like a child. He wanted us to believe like a child. He wanted us to act like a child. When my parents first told me when I was a little kid, they're not Christians, when they told me about Santa Claus, I didn't question them about Santa Claus. Wait a minute. You're going to have to explain to me how this thing works when a fat guy gets in a sleigh and is pulled around by reindeer. Come on now, come on. I just said, well, Dad said it. I'm all for it. You know what? There's a difference there. My father could lie. My mother could lie. But God cannot lie. And if God said it, he can do it. And if we will get back to the level to say, you know, I don't care what bit of knowledge I think I have that exalts itself above what God says, I put that thing under subjection to what God says. I put it below what God says. What God says is true. And when God says I've been set free, you know what? I'm going to walk as a free man. When God says I'm more than a conqueror, then you know what? I guess I am. When God says that I'm thoroughly furnished to every good work, then I guess I am. When God says that he shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory through Christ Jesus, I guess he will. Right? When God says I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, then I guess I am. See? I stopped saying, but Lord, you're going to have to explain to me that because I don't feel it. It's like, oh, my feelings can be wrong. My perception can be wrong. My thoughts can be way off. But the word of God is always true. And the Bible says, let God be true and let every man be a liar. We've got to say, Lord, let your word be above all my experiences, all my thoughts, all my feelings, all my perceptions. Let your word be supreme. When you begin to do that, guess what? Your reality becomes what the word says it is and not what the devil has said it is or man says it is. There's so many things in this life that you can't walk in and you can't partake of until you first start at the very simplest point of saying, I believe it. I believe it because God said it. So many of us think we're going to get to some spiritual height, work up some spiritual, you know, frenzy to where we're at this point. You know, so many of us have this thinking that is so wrong, this perception that is so wrong because the devil wants to keep you bound. And Jesus says, but I made you free and I want you to recognize that you're free. I want you to acknowledge that you're free. I want you to say, hey, if he says I'm free, then I'm free. Okay? And the devil doesn't want you to recognize that. He doesn't want you to acknowledge that. He wants you to say, well, I know what the word says, but. I know what the word says, but. The Bible says that the Lord wants us to acknowledge every good thing that is in us. Yes. Well, there's nothing good dwells in me, not in this flesh. It's like, hey, wait a minute. You got the Holy Spirit in you? You got a good thing in you. And the devil wants you to say, I don't feel close to God right now. You know what? You may not feel close to God, but you couldn't possibly get any closer to God than you are if you have the Holy Spirit in you. Because they that are joined to the Spirit of the Lord have become one spirit. You see, you are so amalgamated with the Lord that you can't slip a piece of paper between the two of you, okay? You're so close, you can't get any closer. You see, two people can be close and can be touching like this, but this is more than that. This is like this. I feel far from God. That's a feeling. It's not a reality. The reality is that you are seated with Christ Jesus right now in heavenly places. right now. But I don't feel that and I don't see that. Yes, I understand what you don't feel and what you don't see because you've been fooled by the illusionist, but you need to begin to accept the reality of what the Word says about you. I don't feel like more than a conqueror. Of course you don't feel like it. It doesn't come in feelings. It's a spiritual thing. And when you begin to acknowledge the truth, say, I believe it because God said it, you can walk in it. You can walk in it. You see, the devil keeps us bound by lies, but we're the ones who choose the lies over what the Word already says. The Word says plainly who we are and what we are and what we have, and we say, no, we don't. No, we're not. You need to make a choice. When you choose the truth, that becomes your reality. Now, sometimes we get stuck in the Old Testament mindset. Thank God we don't live in the Old Testament times. Thank God we don't live in the Old Testament times. You know, I couldn't be a Jew. All the stuff they had to go through, I couldn't do that. God made a simpler way for us. He said, through Christ's finished work, through your faith in him, I receive you as sons and daughters, right? Well, the Old Testament, David was a man who was a man after the Lord's own heart. And David was a man who prayed to God with sincerity. And I read the Psalms pretty much every day. And I love the Psalms. I love the Psalms. And I got to make sure, though, when I'm reading the Psalms that I understand who's speaking them and that I'm different than that guy. And you are, too. You see, the Bible says in the Old Testament, the heavens are God's throne and the earth is his footstool. Yeah. And in the Psalms, you'll find that verse that says, exalt the Lord our God and worship at his footstool. Uh-huh. So God's in the heavenly throne and we're at the footstool. So we picture ourselves down here, you know, like this. Yeah. God's way up there somewhere. And I have to realize that was Old Testament. Things have changed. Because now my old life has passed away. And I've become a brand new creation. And I was a slave and I become a son. And he has lifted me up with him into heavenly realms. And I'm seated right now with Christ Jesus in that heavenly throne. And I'm not at the footstool anymore. I'm sitting up there. And so I don't look at things from the footstool perspective and look up there and go, God, you're so far away. I wish I could have you closer to me. Boy, have you left me, Lord? Are you gone, Lord? I don't look at things that way anymore. I look at things from the other perspective. I'm seated with him. And I look down upon the earth, his footstool. And I look at things not like the grasshopper looking up at the giant, but like a giant looking down at the grasshopper. And I see things from the throne perspective. And the throne perspective says he has put all things under our feet. Okay? All the power of the wicked one is under our feet. Even the elements are subject to our words. Do you know that? I know that's hard to believe, but that's what the Word says. Have you ever seen a real miracle? Have you ever seen something come out of nothing? I have. I've seen fillings appear in her teeth. Out of nothing. Why? Because if you're a believer, okay, you have been given great authority. You've been given great power. You have been given a great position. You're a child of God. You're a son of God. You're a daughter of God. You've been given authority over the things that the devil had authority over, but he doesn't have it anymore because it's been given to us. All the power of the enemy, all the power of every devil combined together, all their forces combined together, and Satan at the head of them all, you have more power than any of them. They've all been put under your feet. But we see things often from the perspective the devil would like us to look at them from, so that we think we're helpless, we're bound, we don't have power. We're powerless. Oh, Lord, someday, if you would just rain down your spirit from heaven, he's going, what are you talking about? I'm in you. Someday, pour out your spirit upon me, Lord. He goes, I'm in you.
That's right.
You know? Remember that woman that was looking for the lost penny?
Yeah.
You know what? It wasn't lost. She just didn't know where it was. It was still in her house. It was still in her house. She just didn't know where it was. So many of us have so much inside of us because of the Holy Spirit that we just don't know we got it in there. But it's there already. You can walk in it now. I had a man call me this week on Thursday. And this man has a worldwide healing evangelism ministry. And he knows every big name you can name, they're friends of his. Every worldwide name, he knows them personally. And he called me. He wanted to ask me some questions. And he said to me something. I said, yeah, that's it. He said, so how did this all start with you, you know, praying for people? And I said, well, I saw this man. And he goes, let me tell you how it started for me. He said, there was this man, and the man's dead now, and I don't remember his name, Prophet somebody, was in Africa. And he said, and this man had a healing ministry where 17,000 people got out of their wheelchairs and walked during his ministry. 17,000 people walked out of wheelchairs and never went back. And he said, he went to this man, and he said, I want to know the secret. How can I walk in that kind of power? And the man said, well, actually, you've already got it. Don't you need to impart it to me? Don't you need to lay hands on me and give me some special impartation? He goes, no, actually, you've already got it. He says, all you need to do is change your thinking, and you'll have it. That's all he did. And he changed the way he thought. Oh, I have it. I can do it. And things started to happen. You see, where the devil deceives you is in your mind. He gets you to thinking you don't have what you already have. You can't do what you already can do. And you know what? If you believe it, you'll live that. So how can we get all that junk out of our mind? Well, you just take it back to the beginning. What did the Word of God say about you? What does the Word of God say? What does the Word of God say that you've been given? What does the Word of God say about your authority? What does the Word of God say about your position in Christ? What does the Word of God say about how the enemy interacts with you? Do you have power over him? Yes, you do.
I think so.
You see, some people are afraid of the devil. Mm-hmm. And they don't understand. Because you're afraid of the devil, he's not afraid of you. But if you know who you are, he's afraid of you. He's afraid of you.
Amen.
If you knew who you were, if you knew the power you have, one of the greatest revelations you're going to get the day you step into heaven, the day you meet Jesus face to face, the revelation of how much you could have done if you just realized what you really had, how much you could have done. So let's go back to the beginning. If you've accepted Jesus Christ into your heart and life, the Son has made you free. You may not recognize that. You may not realize that, but you need to acknowledge that. Because when you come to the knowledge of the truth will set you free. And when you say, you know what? I am free. You know what? This area that I think I'm bound in, the problem is the way I'm thinking. I'm thinking I'm bound. I need to begin walking as a free man. You know, I'm not that old person. I'm a brand new person. You know, that man, that old man, he's dead. Why do I keep trying to live his life? I'm living a new life. You know, I was a slave, but I'm not a slave anymore, right? Change the way you think and align your thinking with what the Word of God says. And when you do that, you'll begin to live the life that God prepared for you. And here's the thing, too. There's some people that are so focused on certain things in life that they can't see the big picture. Now, I'll give you an example. Here's what you won't hear in this church, and if you have a hunger for it, I'm sorry, but you're going to miss out. I'm not going to sit up here every week and preach on how Israel and the Arab states and the president and all and the Pope and all this stuff's interacting, and it's the end is going to happen any day. I'm not going to preach about all that stuff. You know why? The end is going to happen. Jesus is going to come. But your focus needs to be on the lost. Not on, you've already got your parachute packed. You need to help somebody else pack their parachute. You already got pulled into the lifeboat. You need to pull somebody else in the lifeboat. It's not all about, I'm ready, Lord. I've got my parachute on. Just tell me when to jump. I want to get out of here. You know what? You don't need to get out of here. You need to get somebody else into the boat. See? Jesus came here not to get out of here. He came here to save the lost. And Jesus left us here at this point still so that we can help to save the lost. Amen. You see, just because you got your house in order doesn't mean it's done deal. Now you need to get somebody else's house in order. You need to bring somebody else into the kingdom. You need to bring somebody else to the Lord Jesus. You see, you also think this because it's your messed up thinking, because that's what the devil does. He messes with our thinking. You think, my job is this right now. I got saved, and the rest of my job is self-improvement. The rest of my life, I'll keep honing myself and working on myself. You know what? I'm going to tell you the best way to grow spiritually. Get out there and start doing what God's told you to do. When you get out there, you learn so much more. You see, there's so many things that you can learn in college about. You know, you can go to business school, and you can learn how to be an administrator, and you can learn about all that stuff. You know what? You don't know anything until you step into the job and do it. That's where you really learn. You can take language for 3 years like I did, and you can speak a little bit of it. But when you go and live in the country for 3 years, everything changes. You can say, someday I'm going to step out into ministry. Someday I'm going to talk to others about Jesus. Someday I'm going to pray for the sick. You know what? You can get all prepared and read all the books about it, but until you go and do it, it ain't going to happen, okay? Your best growth, your biggest growth, your greatest spiritual growth will happen when you get involved in doing what God has called you to do. It's doing. You see, that's why he says it's not the hearers only, but the hearers that do. They're the ones. They're the ones that reap the benefits. They're the ones that live the new life. They're the ones that enjoy all the fruit of the Spirit. They're the ones. So, you've been born again, that's a wonderful thing. You've been born as a free man, that's a wonderful thing. You need to now begin to acknowledge what the Bible says about you. And you need to recognize all those things that don't feel right. Like, well, I don't feel free, so I feel like I'm lying. You have to realize those are all feelings. And those are subject to deception. The devil will trick you. The devil will confuse you. The devil will create illusions. But the word of God is always true, no matter what. No matter what. It's always true. All right. So I want to say this is if you have never asked Jesus to come into your heart and be your Lord and Savior, then you don't have eternal life. And you're lost. And you're in a world of darkness. And your destiny in eternity is not good. But the glorious, wonderful news of the gospel, the good news is that you don't have to be that way for another second because Jesus will save you right now. So if you've never accepted him in your heart, today's the day you can do that and change your whole eternity and you can be with Jesus forever in heaven. Now, if you have never accepted Jesus and you would like to right now, I want to ask you to raise your hand. Anybody? I don't know if there's anybody in here who hasn't asked Jesus in their heart, but sometimes I ask and I'm surprised who raises their hand. So I'm asking. If you have not accepted Jesus, raise your hand. We want to pray for you. All right. Let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Father, in Jesus' name, we believe you, Lord. You are the truth. You said you're the truth. We're going to believe every word you've said. You're the truth. Our experience is not the truth. Our feelings are not the truth. You're the truth. We don't base our lives on what we see or what we feel, we base it on what you've said. We acknowledge that you're true and that your word is true and that our lives are what you say they are. That we are who you say we are. We have what you say we have. And we just renew our minds today to those things, Lord. We say, we're going to stop thinking the old way and start thinking the new way. We're going to start seeing things through your eyes, from your perspective, Lord. And Lord Jesus, right now we just ask, Lord, that every part of our heart that has not been yielded to you, Lord, that every part of our heart that has been holding out, every part of our heart that's been in disagreement with you, Lord, we want to just say, Lord, we yield that to you right now. We yield our hearts to you right now. We yield ourselves to you wholly right now. Every part of us that has been afraid to step out, every part of us that has said, I can't witness to people, I can't call people into the house of God, I can't tell people about Jesus, every one of those objections that we've had, we just cast them all down where they belong, to the pit of hell. And we say, Lord Jesus, we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. And Lord, we ask you to give us opportunities that we can be used in your kingdom, that we can bring many people into your kingdom, that every one of our lives can count for something great on this earth because we didn't just get into heaven ourselves, we brought somebody else. That we weren't too shy to tell them, but we told them about Jesus. Lord, give us your boldness. Grant, Lord, that even as we pray for people, that signs and wonders follow that will confirm your word. We thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in our lives. We declare ourselves as free to do what you've told us we can do, Lord. And we thank you for all that you've done. And Lord, we want to walk forth boldly now, from now on. We want to walk forth and proclaim your kingdom and do your will. We submit our lives to you. We give ourselves as a living sacrifice right now. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Did you want to say something? Oh, all right. Let me get your microphone. You want to turn on this mic? Right here.
Debbie is talking.
It's on the trip.
Hello?
So, Pastor Tom, something I struggled with, and I think that goes with your sermon, that I felt the Lord wanted to share, is that we are just called to do what we're supposed to do, which is to believe. But the outcome, I think for many of us, for me anyway, I struggled with the outcome. In other words, I would pray for somebody, maybe they didn't get healed right then. And so then I'd get discouraged in my spirit, and it would make me timid about wanting to reach out again. And the Lord helped me with that because he told me, for whatever reason they're not healed, okay? There can be a myriad of reasons. He just told me, all I call you to do, child, is to do what I've told you. I don't have to figure out why not, why, how come her, not him. And when I got set free from that, it actually made me feel better, because otherwise it was like I didn't want to do anything then for fear of failure. So the Lord just is saying right now, just to be obedient with the faith that you have. And he loves you, and he's not expecting you to have an outcome. He's going to give the outcome. But in the obedience and in the love that motivates you to do the things you do in your life, there's a reward, because even one who gives a prophet a cup of water, the Bible says he receives a prophet's reward. So when we do our part, no more, no less, just what Jesus calls each of us to do, there's a reward regardless of what our eyes see or don't see. There is something in it, in our being obedient, and that's all we have to, we don't have to worry about the outcome. Did I fail? Am I not faithful enough? None of that. He wants you to be free, to just be obedient to his truth, and he's the one that will make things happen.
Amen. 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 All right. Well, we want to thank you for coming today. We want to remind you, Wednesday night we start our new series right here in the sanctuary. If you're an adult, come in here and you're going to join with us. Whether you got the book or not, show up and God's going to really bless you. Amen.